Thank you, Anna. So let me first share the screen. Okay. I just want to make sure that everyone can see the screen. Is that okay?
Yes, yes, it seems okay.
Okay. Okay, so in this seminar, I will present my book, Quantum Programming Illustrated. The presentation will be in the form of snippets from the book. Since I will go through various topics, I will assume that the audience is familiar with some basics of quantum computing. So my primary motivation was to write a book that won't approach quantum computing as a mathematical abstraction, but from the practical point of view. I wanted to write a book one can understand without previous knowledge of quantum physics and mathematics. As you know, there are a lot of books that are mainly mathematical. So this is book timeline. The first Kindle edition of the first version of the book was published on Amazon in June 2020. An updated version in July this year. A printed version was published in August 2021 in Saudi Arabia, where I was working at the time. I was hoping for the Serbian edition early next year, but I'm not sure it is going to happen. The book has more than 300 pages with at least one illustration on a spread. The book also contains 25 complete code examples that can be tested online on IBM quantum computing platform. To make the book more friendly and inspired by Alice in Wonderland, as you see from the title page, I'm using characters of Alice and the rabbit Bob. From chapter to chapter, a reader can follow their adventures and learn from their solutions to various quantum problems. Every chapter ends with one or more math boxes. A math box, in a simple way, summarizes the mathematical concepts used in the chapter. For example, this one summarizes the concept of power of two used in beginners' computer courses. So the book is divided into three parts. The first part is about basic concepts of quantum computing. The second part, in an easy way, introducing linear algebra from the quantum computing perspective. And the third part deals with the quantum algorithms. So part one of the book consists of two chapters. The basic concepts chapter, in an easy way, explain basic concepts of quantum computing. And the second chapter is a quick start to quantum programming. The book defines units of computation in a clear and a simple way. A qubit is a unit of data, a quantum gate is a unit of computation, and a quantum program is equivalent to quantum circuit. To introduce the basic concept of quantum computing, like superposition, entanglement, and measurement, I use a coin metaphor. For example, the quantum superposition principle says that a quantum object, which can exist in one of the several possible states, can also exist in all of these states at the same time. So in this example, a coin can exist in two states, zero up and one up. And when spinning, we can say that the coin exists in both states at 1, 0, and 1. This state is analogous to superposition in a quantum world. Another concept using quantum computing is quantum entanglement. In the book, it is explained by using a metaphor of a pair of coins spinning in a high correlation. If coins are perfectly correlated, then if one of the coin lands on one side, the other one will also land on the same time, on the same side, and it can land on the same time or any time after, but it will be the same side. The third concept is a quantum measurement. So the measurement process can be compared to touching the spinning coin. After being touched, the coin lands randomly either to side zero or to side one. In quantum computing, measurement is the process of extracting information from a quantum system. This information is hidden otherwise during the computation. So a concept of probabilistic computing and interpretation of random result is a new concept for people starting with quantum computing. Also, many beginners are not familiar with histograms. In this book, histograms are introduced by an experiment for testing fairness of a coin. The coin is tossed 100 times and outcomes are counted and presented as vertical bars. If the coin were fair, we would have bars similar in sizes. This will be the same sizes. Otherwise, we can assume that one side of the coin is heavier than the other. In this example, we recorded outcome 165 times and outcome 0.35 times. So our coin is definitely not fair. We also learned that the probability of getting zero is 0.35 and the probability of getting one is 0.65. When the same principle is applied to quantum computing, we can say that the result of computation becomes apparent only after repeating the same computation many times and drawing results histogram. Basic unit of quantum information, a qubit, can be visualized as a spinning coin. Probability of the coin landing on zero or one depends on the weight of that side of a coin. We can even algebraically describe our coin as a weighted sum. So the state of the spinning coin, let's call it ket S, is equal to the sum of weight A associated with the state zero and weight B associated with the state one. So this formula here is algebraic model of a basic unit of information. Qubit. To adjust this model to laws of quantum mechanics, which are definitely different, we can say that the probability of measuring a particular state, zero or one, is equal not to the weight, but to the square of the weight of that state. In this context, weights A and B are called probability amplitudes. This rule is known as a Born rule. It is interesting that in his 1926 paper, German physicist Max Born initially confused probability and probability amplitudes. So here at the top, you see the German version of the paper and the bottom English translation. And I just circled his mistake in a paper. Later, he corrects this by adding a footnote. So this is the footnote, which is actually correction. And the legend has it that this footnote led him to a Nobel Prize in physics. So this footnote is probably the most famous footnote in science. Another model of a qubit, in addition to algebraic, is a vector model of a qubit, which I'll also introduce as a metaphor. So imagine that you can control a coin spin by turning a knob. If the knob's indicator is horizontal, the coin is in state ket zero. And if it's vertical, the coin is in a state ket one. So on a higher level of abstraction, we can represent the knob outline as a circle of radius one and the knob indicator as an arrow of length one. So this circle represents a unit circle and arrow represents a qubit state vector. So now in this model, this is qubit, these vectors, qubit in different states. So we can now express any possible state of the of qubit by multiplying state ket 0 and ket 1 with the coefficients a and b and adding them up. So this is something which we know from the primary school, how to add up vectors. In this example, a is 0, 6. Let's see, the mouse is disappearing. A is 0, 6 and b is 0, 8. Also by applying Pythagoras theorem to this triangle, we can even deduct the normalization constraint, which says that all probabilities must add up to one. And mathematically, this is known as normalization constraint. And also from the everyday life, we know that probability of all events must add up to one. It is sometimes useful to visualize only probability amplitudes. To do this, basic states are written on the horizontal axis, like ket 0, ket 1, different examples. And the associated amplitudes are drawn as bars. From this graph, you can see that amplitudes can be positive 0 or even negative. As you know, in everyday life, like weight of the something cannot be negative. But this is possible in quantum world. So probability amplitude can be added together or even cancel each other, which is another important phenomenon called quantum interference. So similarly to a qubit, quantum gates here at the top are introduced without mathematics, simply as a software devices that change qubit state in a certain way. Each of the gates is also given a symbol and a unique name. And to create a quantum circuit, a qubit is assigned a name and given a line along which it travels, for example, qubit Q0, Q1, etc. And it's given a line to which travels. Along it travels, it encounters different quantum gates. So IBM online development tools called Quantum Composer allows programmer to create circuits by simply dragging and dropping gates on qubit lines, like here. By simply stating gate names followed by a qubit name, we can create a quantum program in IBM Open Quantum Assembly Language, also called CASM. This example shows how easy it is to convert a circuit into CASM program. This is also done automatically by IBM Quantum Composer. One of the simplest practical examples given in the book is a quantum random number generator. The generator circuit consists of just three edge gates that put each of the qubits in an equal superposition like a spinning coin. Output of each of the gates is then measured. Since quantum mechanics is inherently random, the output will be a true random number between 0 and 7. Every example, like this one, is presented as a circuit, as a CASM code, and the results of the computation show as a histogram. Typically, every example given in a book is run 1024 times to generate this kind of histograms. Some of more complex circuits in a quick start sections are half and full adder, so half adder and full adder. This is for people who were wondering, can quantum computer add 1 plus 1? It turns out it can, but the result is not always 2. Again, these circuits can still be explained by following a simple logic as qubit change along the lines. So again, no mathematics is needed to understand these circuits. By looking at the quantum circuits, people usually imagine some hardware consisting of wires connecting physical quantum gates. To put things into perspective, this book describes a superconducting quantum processor. So this diagram shows 4 qubits as a small superconducting circuits. They are here in the center, And these qubits are interconnected by microwave radiators, which are green and blue. And the quantum gates does not exist as a physical devices, but rather they are microwave pulses of different frequencies and duration applied through these radiators. In this diagram, green radiators act as gates, and the blue radiators act as measurement gates or qubit readouts. The other important feature of quantum processor is qubit interconnectivity. In this diagram, we see that all qubits are interconnected by green radiators. But in multi-qubit quantum processor, this is not always possible, especially if you have more than 10 or 50. As a matter of interest, just a few weeks ago, IBM released a new generation of quantum chips named the Eagle. The chip has 127 qubits built into 3D architecture, consists of number of planes. So there is a qubit plane consisting of superconducting qubits. Underneath is a readout plane. Can you see also the very small radiators? And following by qubit wiring and the qubit signals delivery plane, which is at the bottom. So otherwise, IBM plan by the end of the next year to even double this and get more than 200 qubits chip. Part two of the book is dedicated to mathematics of quantum computing. Since quantum computing is based on linear algebra, this part of the book gradually introduces all necessary concepts from basic definition of linearity, then through matrices and matrix operations, vectors, vector operations, and linear transformations, to advanced topic of designing operators. One of the skills a quantum algorithm developer must have is operator construction skills. In essence, a developer is often required to map certain input into certain outputs, which is performed by a matrix operator. The book describes three methods for these operator constructions in detail. These are inner and outer product method, as well as a shortcut method. A separate challenge is how to decompose an operator into available quantum gates, which is also illustrated by examples. For example, let's say you develop this operator, which does something, but you just can't translate it to quantum circuit because such a thing doesn't exist as a gate. So you need to decompose this matrix. In this simple example, with a little bit of ideas, you can see that this can be decomposed in H gate and S dagger gate. This part of the book also describes more advanced models like block sphere and density matrix. In the advanced programming framework section, all quantum gates are revisited and analyzed as a matrix operator. So till now, as I mentioned, the people couldn't see, the people didn't actually were operating in matrices. It was just cat zeros and cat ones. This section of the book also shows step-by-step development of mathematical models of IBM Universal Quantum Gate. Perhaps not all readers will have patience to go through this mathematical analysis, but I included it anyway for people who would be curious to find more about how this gate works, since this is the only hardware gate in a IBM quantum computer. In other words, there is only one gate. All these gates are made in software. The book also presents the methodology for constructing 2-qubit and 3-qubit control gates. This is an interesting topic since the methodology is still subject to research. And the part three of the book presents selection of quantum algorithms. When presenting algorithm, the emphasis was on three cornerstones of quantum computing. Superposition that allows processing a large number of inputs in a single run, interference that allows canceling unwanted computational result and enhances correct ones, and entanglement that allows instant sharing of information among qubits. So the first algorithm described in the book is the Grover algorithm for unsorted database search. For example, the task is to find a specific card in a file containing an unsorted card. To find the card in a classical way, the only thing one can do is to pick up a card randomly until the card is found. With a lot of luck, this can be achieved in a few tries, but in average, it will require up half of the to open up half of the old cards. Quantum algorithm does the same task in a square root of n picks, where n is the number of cards. For example, if we have a trillion cards and both classical and quantum computer need 1 microsecond to check a card, a classical computer would find the target in 1 week, and the quantum computer would need only 1 second. Only required number of operation is 1 trillion for classical and 1 million for a quantum computer. To describe algorithm as simple as possible, the example in the book use 4 cards, which are indexed by binary numbers from 00 to 11, and they are shuffled. And the goal is to find the card with the index 10 in the least amount of steps possible. To code for 4 indices, we need 2 qubits only. The first step of the Grover algorithm places 2 qubits into equal superposition coding for 4 indices. So these are indices presenting index cards, and because they're all in equal superposition. So in this diagram, you can see all these bars are the same. At this point, they all have same amplitudes, and the goal of the algorithm is to locate the correct index and to extract it. In the second step, the algorithm locates and inverts the target index by using a function called oracle. In general, an oracle is a function that cannot solve a problem, but if presented with the right answer, it can recognize it. It is visualized here as a piece of paper with a hole that matches the right answer. So the oracle can push down only the target amplitude. Now, inverting the target amplitude mathematically means applying identity matrix to the state vector with the -1 at the amplitude we wish to invert. So you can see it's here. So once the right answer is singled out, we need to remove or to minimize all the other possibilities, which are in this case, these blue ones. So this process ensures that the measurement will produce the correct answer. So the Grover did this by inverting amplitude by their mean, and he used the operator he called the diffusion operator. In this example, all amplitudes are inverted around 0.25, which is average value of all amplitude. So by inverting them around this, this process canceled all the blue amplitude and actually enhanced the correct answer. So the quantum measurement will almost certainly produce the correct results. So this is an example of combining superposition with quantum interference. So just let's have a look how Grover diffusion operator works. How did Grover manage to invert amplitudes in one step? So from the basic geometry, we know that when a point, this point reflects over some horizontal line, it changes y coordinate to m minus y. So moving to a multidimensional vector space, we would need an operator, let's call it D, that will do the same transformation for every point of the state vector. So when this operator is applied, all the amplitudes are inverted by the common mean. So it turns out that this is not that complicated. And Grover came up with a diffusion operator that depends solely on number of problem dimensions. So this is the Grover diffusion operator. Now, putting the whole algorithm in a matrix form, we get a simple expression consisting of three matrix multiplication representing Grover algorithm. So we start from two qubits in superposition, to which we apply oracle, which inverts our amplitude, and then we simply apply diffusion operator. Now, when we multiply everything, we get a final state in the matrix form or in a cat form, which is the index we were searching for. So just an observation, when this is example for n equals 4, only when you have 4 cards. If you have more than 4 cards, 8 or maybe 1 trillion cards, you have to reapply this operator in a loop a few times until you get desired answer or desired amplitude high enough to ensure the correct outcome of the measurement. So just an illustration, this is a practical implementation of algorithm shown, and this is given in the book. It's a little bit optimized, so I won't go into it. But in general, as you can see, it's a quite simple and short program. This is a quick comparison between classical and quantum search. Classical algorithm is linear. If you remember, you have to pick up cards randomly, which can last forever. While quantum is sublinear and grows with the square root of the number of input. As number of input grows, the quantum algorithm performs better and better compared to a classical one. The other algorithm presented in the book are swap test, super dense coding, quantum teleportation, and the Deutsch-Jose algorithm, all of them featuring Alice and Bob. For example, swap test allows anonymous comparison of two quantum states. So let's say Alice and Bob have a secret message they want to send to headquarters, but and they want their messages to be compared, because they cannot communicate with each other. But the message mustn't be open. It must be compared and stay as it is. Even quantum computer mustn't know what is inside the message. So this is possible by using something like swap test. The second one, super dense coding, allows sending 2 bits of information over 1 entangled qubit pair. So it's called super dense because basically you imprint 2 bits into 1 qubit, although you need another entangled qubit, but still it's 2 bits per qubit. That's why it's called super dense coding. quantum teleportation allows sending qubit state over again entangled pair. Again, this is not a real teleportation. Instead of teleporting a person or an object, we teleport a state. So the qubit state is teleported. So who knows, maybe this is a future of teleportation. You teleport information about the object. Object is can be recreated on the other side. And when the object is created, at the same time, the object at the source disappears by itself. So it's not possible to have 2 objects. So you cannot create clone of yourself. finally, Deutsch-Jose algorithm, which is more of theoretical values, discover if a function has a certain property. For this one, I really struggled to find a real life example. So I came in a scenario when Alice is trying blue and red outfits, and she asked Bob about opinion, which one is better, and Bob trying to be correct and not to offend Alice. So if you read the book, you will see how that ends up. So in the book appendix, there is a quick introduction to Python programming language as a language itself, like from scratch, and a short overview of IBM and Rigetti Python programming libraries with a few working examples. And finally, if you are interested in getting a book as a Kindle, as usual, Amazon is the place to go. And if you're interested what we at the Institute are doing, you can visit the website qcict.org. So I'm ready for your questions, if any.
I don't see any questions in the chat. However, if anyone has any question, you can just tell them now. No need for typing.
So just to say that the book is available on Amazon for $5. I'm not sure how easy it is to get it from Serbia. Some people had trouble. Even if it's electronic version, I don't have any physical copies anymore, unfortunately. So at the moment, it's only Kindle version.
Okay, so if not,
Aleksandar, thank you very much. This was a really excellent introduction to your book. And by the way, I bought your book and I've read it. I've just finished. I will give you also the recommendation. Really, I enjoyed it very much.
Thank you.
It's easy to read, but it is not just like a simple, you know, things. So you're getting really in the mathematical explanation and explanation of all these gates and how they are being constructed and everything. So it was very helpful for me. So I recommend really for people who would like to learn quantum computing, this is the way to start with. Also, you mentioned the way how custom operators can be constructed, and that is, you know, something that is very important for the developers of quantum applications. I wanted to ask you actually about this. How can we, you are showing how to create a simple operator for the states of two basis states and simple quantum states of two qubits. So for example, if there isn't, you know, we have more and more qubits there. So we want to be able to exploit this. What would you say? How to create a custom operator for 10, 20 or more qubits?
Oh.
Is it impossible really, or what?
That's a really tricky question. It's a matrix nightmare probably.
Yeah.
But usually when you have this bigger amount of qubits, there is a lot of repetition. Or you can divide your algorithm in smaller chunks. Or as I said, there is probably repetition of the if you divided quantum register in a few or sub-registers that usually repeat themselves. So, but there is no easy way of doing it.
Mm.
That's really difficult. And again, another part is also even more difficult: how to deconstruct that operator to fit into your quantum gates.
Yeah.
And as I hope as a quantum computing progress, it will be easier and easier. So now people are busy making a lot of libraries. So maybe one day it will be just drag and drop and there will be no programming at all. So.
And actually, I mean, what is the thought process? I mean, in the end, you have the section about this foundational algorithms, Grover's algorithm, Doijosa, and teleportation, etc. But for example, when you want to build really some practical cases in quantum computer, what is the thought process? How do you approach this? What do you do? How do you convert a kind of computational problem into this operators and gates?
Again, that's a difficult. That's why we have very few clever people who can do that, and not so many quantum algorithms. Because one of the difficulties in quantum algorithm, you don't have your thought process is not like a thought process when developing normal algorithms. As you see, and that's why I chose Grover algorithm as a simpler example. I mean, I don't have any idea why did he come to that idea of inverting about the mean and how to come to the matrix, but it was just strike of the genius. So also there are other algorithms like Deutsch-Jose algorithm, which is basically just very complicated thing, which basically that does nothing useful. But I think that this is a very difficult process, and I didn't check for a while the algorithm zoo. There is a website. Someone is collecting all the quantum algorithms. But last time I checked, it was about a couple of dozens algorithms, and most of them are not very useful, and you wouldn't know how to use them. And the other day, the Honeywell announced some huge news. It's kind of funny. I have the example here, how to create a random number generator. So apparently Honeywell now announced they create a first truly random number generator using quantum computer, and they are selling that program. So I don't know what is behind that program, but probably it's not as simple as my example, but they mentioned they have some entanglement and who knows what. But so far, I couldn't find anything useful, anything beyond proof of concept. But the thing is also, we didn't have a quantum processor. So we are only now 15 days into having the 127 qubits Eagle processor, which probably will be the first one you can use for something useful. For example, with my students, I was using some proof of concept. For example, we were doing cancer detection. So you have a data sets, medical data sets, and for example, you can take patients' information in a text form, like certain measurements, blood pressure, and MRI, and whatever. And then you apply quantum algorithm to detect, is that patient based on the data provided he has a cancer or not. But again, this was again 5-qubit example. But I hope maybe in the next instance we can do something more useful. So what I want to say also, the implementation or developing on a quantum algorithm depends on real life examples. Or I would say real life demands, which we don't have yet, except maybe cybersecurity, which is now pressing the issue, especially now when we have 127 qubits and the possibility of breaking the RSA code.
So actually the learning curve is quite long, and it requires really...
It's long and difficult, and there are no shortcuts.
Yeah, there are no templates actually.
No templates, and then your everyday logic, you cannot apply your same logic to quantum algorithms you use and you maybe in a way it will be used, maybe people who get to use MATLAB and all these matrix multiplications, maybe they will if they used to think in matrices, maybe it will be a little bit easier. Or maybe games developers, but again, game developers works in a 3D space, and quantum computing is like now with 127 qubit. I mean, it's I don't know, trillions dimensions.
Yeah, I remember I've read somewhere observation that there is only every 2 years on average there is a new algorithm actually appearing, even though there is quite a lot of people working on that and trying to invent something to improve, or but it's really not a lot of, I mean, it's very difficult to come up with a really new quantum algorithm.
Yes, it is very difficult. And it doesn't really make sense to reinvent the old ones. Like, I think that's what's happening in machine learning. They start applying machine learning algorithm to quantum, and they realize, oh, maybe it's better just to forget about all the style algorithms and start from scratch, doing something completely different.
Yeah, very interesting.
As I said in my example, it doesn't make sense to make program one plus one, because your answer won't be two, and it will be everything from zero to three or four.
What is actually the next step after your book? I mean, what is your recommendation? You know, people start learning and they buy your book, they go through that, and they have a foundation. So how to continue? What would you recommend as a kind of learning path?
So I guess many people who bought my book already made an account with IBM IBM account, or maybe some even made account with the Microsoft or Microsoft Azure, who also offers quantum services, but that's very costly, same as Amazon. I mean, you pay sometimes $1,000 per run, and which is so my recommendation is maybe just continue to that path and try and start with the Qiskit. Many people actually with Qiskit, which is a Python library for the quantum computing. So the book for the Qiskit is available online. IBM wrote it, but again, I found it very complicated. They somehow, these people cannot get rid of quantum mechanics. They are just dragging it with them. And all these psis and phis and, you know, this quantum mechanics notations and matrices and but anyway, so the next step would be starting with Qiskit, and especially if you know Python, try to maybe combine your classical and the quantum algorithms. Even if it's quantum part of your algorithm, something simple, let's say like generate a random number, just try to incorporate it into your classical Python program, and then maybe. When you start solving some real life problems, you will maybe grow that quantum part of your algorithm. And that is also the way I see the quantum computing will go. So we won't have quantum computer replacing classical computer. It will be just a computer with a quantum coprocessor. So many people probably don't remember, but probably were not even born. In 1980s, when we have PCs, then it was a big thing then when Intel announced quantum, floating point coprocessor. And then all of a sudden you had a two processor inside computer. So you think computer like two parts, but eventually it became one. So this is also going on with the quantum. So IBM nicely incorporated in their library Qiskit, the standard computing, classical computing, and quantum computing, and eventually it will become one. So in brief, continue with Python. Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Great. And what is your next project? Are you working on another book?
I actually started with the Python programming, also even simpler. Because what I've... So the thing, I didn't do this book in Python, because it's Python is basically just a wrapper around the chasm with a very complicated and long syntax. As you know, you have write lines and lines of code for something you can write in two lines on chasm, and it's actually the same thing. But since it become more popular, I might continue writing the Python book again with a twist. So with no quantum mechanics, with the least mathematics as possible. And maybe with more practical examples, maybe towards machine learning. So I'll see. Yes.
Maybe something for the kids? Is there something for high schoolers?
Yeah, actually, that was one of the working title of my book, Quantum Programming for High School Dropouts. But as you know, the book after chapter, mathematic chapter, it's not really for dropouts, but it became as it is. But yes, maybe.
Okay, thank you very much.
I was also hoping to get this book. There was some interest to publish in Serbia, but it seems it won't happen. So I'll see.
Oh, okay. I remember you showed just at the beginning of this,
yes,
this seminar that there was something planned for the next year.
Yes, yes.
Okay, but it will be on hold for the time being.
Yes, and it has been updated. And the nice thing about Kindle is you can continue updating your book. It's not like when you print it and that's it, and people must buy it again. Fortunately, Amazon allows you to just re-download the new version, which is nice.
Well, I hope you'll be able eventually to publish it in Serbian. It's really wonderful.
Thanks.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Aleksandar. I'll let the others ask questions, or maybe there are some in the chat.
So in the chat, there is one question, I believe, about the use of quantum computing in communications. Maybe a comment about that?
Yes. I'm not an expert. I just know from the popular literature that Chinese are big in that they managed to do quantum communication between a number of cities in China, I think covering a couple of hundred kilometers span. So that was a real achievement. And that is the basis for probably quantum internet. Otherwise, China is the nation which has the biggest investment in quantum computing. I mean, I think it's something 11 billion in euros, and the next one is like 4 or 5 billion, the next country. I'm not sure which one is Germany or something, but China is by far the... And also another interesting thing I read the other day about Chinese, they apparently they published a paper, they managed to measure the speed of entanglement, which is, I think it's 1 trillion meters per second. I don't know how they managed to do it. So far we thought it's instant, but it seems it might have a limit. But still, if you remember, the speed of light is 300,000 meters per second. So can you imagine if you can do communications with 1 trillion meters per second? So far, as far as we know at the moment, this is forbidden by law of physics. we can exchange information, the entangled qubit exchange information randomly, immediately, even if they are on the separate side of the universe. It can be in instant or it 1 trillion meters per second. But the problem is we cannot retrieve that information without sending a classical information over the. So that thing that sending classical information over the line actually spoils the whole concept. But people are more and more bold talking about possibility of using the quantum entanglement and basically unlimited communication speed. So if that happens, we'll have really fast internet.
That would be nice. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
I believe there are no more questions. Okay. So if there aren't any questions, then that would be all. And thank you for this presentation and for your time.
Thank you for inviting me.
And thanks to everyone for joining. And if you'd like to keep track of the activities from this community, you can find us on Meetup and on LinkedIn. If you already haven't, you can find the link. That's it.